I do not know what has become of Harley Warren. It is true that I have been his closest friend and share of his terrible studies. I will not deny that this witness of yours saw us together walking toward Big Cypress Swamp at 11:30 on that awful night. I only know what I have already told you, and why Harley Warren did not return, he alone could tell. The research of Harley Warren was made known to me as we read from his vast collection of rare forbidden books. The fiend-inspired tome was written in characters I'd never seen elsewhere. Warren always dominated me in our studies, and sometimes I feared him. But I do not fear him now, for I suspect he has known horrors beyond my ken. Now I fear for him. Our object that night had something to do with the book that Warren had with him. But I swear I do not know what we expected to find. The picture, seared into my soul, is of one scene only. The place was a cemetery so ancient that I trembled at the manifold signs of immemorial years. Warren and I were the first to invade a lethal silence of centuries. We stopped before a half-obliterated tomb. Then, without delay, we seized our spades and commenced to clear away the drifted earth from the archaic mortuary. From the black aperture rushed an effluence of nauseous, miasmal gases. The stone steps were dripping with some detestable ichor and bordered by moist walls encrusted with nitre.
Randolph, I'll have to ask you to stay on the surface. It's fiendish work. You can't imagine the things I'll have to see and do. But I promise to keep you informed of every move.
I was desperately anxious to accompany my friend into those depths, yet he proved inflexible. I listened with feverish anxiety for more than a quarter of an hour, yet heard nothing. Then a faint clicking came from the instrument.
God, you can see what I'm seeing, Carter. It's terrible. It's monstrous. It's unbelievable.
Warren, what is it? What is it?
I can't tell you, Carter. It's too utterly beyond thought. Great God, I never dreamed of this!
Warren! Warren, what is it?
Carter, for the love of God, put the slab back and get out of this if you can! Leave everything and make for the outside! It's your only chance!
Around me were the tombs in darkness and the shadows. Beyond me, some peril beyond the radius of human imagination. But even through my fear, I felt a vague resentment that he should deem me capable of deserting him.
Warren, brace up! I'm coming down!
Cut up those damn steps and run for your life!
Warren! Warren! Answer me! Are you there?
Hello, peoples of the internet. I bet you're wondering, who the hell are we?
That's a logical question to ask.
I am Dexter, and this is Chuck. And as I'm sure you're able to imply by our black hoods and big knives, we are cultists.
And this is our cultist clubhouse.
Technically, we agreed to call it a cult house.
Cult house doesn't sound as inviting as clubhouse.
Yeah, but we're not clubbists, are we? We're cultists. And a cult is just like a club, only slightly more aggressive. We are like Girl Scouts, but instead of selling cookies, we sell insanity. And we sell it for free.
Plus a small non-refundable application fee.
That's right. For just a small amount of money, you too could be a member of our super fun kick-ass cult.
Now, we realize there are a lot of cults on the internet out there asking you for your time, money, and immortal soul.
We only want two of those things at a time.
The point is, our cult is nothing to be afraid of. It's not based on some weird, made-up religion. It's based on the writings of horror writer H.P. Lovecraft. Uh-huh. You may be wondering, who the hell is H.P. Lovecraft?
Don't say it. We have to leave room on the tape so I can put in the cool graphics.
What cool graphics?
There's gonna be like green mist in letters that shake that say the thing.
You mean who the hell is H.P. Love?
Don't say it. Wait. Patient.
Who the hell is H.P.? Who the hell is... Who the hell is H.P. Lovecraft?
The course of H.P. Lovecraft's life was altered by an unfortunate madness. In April of 1893, his father, a commercial traveler from the vicinity of Boston, was on business in Chicago. It was there that Winfield Scott Lovecraft experienced the general paralysis of the insane. Winfield's violent hallucinations would soon place him in Butler Hospital. His troubled wife, Susan Phillips Lovecraft, was forced to return home to her family in Providence, Rhode Island. With Susie was her two-year-old son, Howard Phillips Lovecraft. Today, the man readers of weird fiction know as H.P. Lovecraft is ranked alongside America's best writers.
Defined the themes and obsessions of 20th century horror, and as we chug on into the 21st century, it doesn't seem to be going away.
He let drop away all the trappings of what is called horror, and he moved into some narrative peculiar to himself. He invented his own genre, really.
Lovecraft tells you about the scale of man in the cosmos. You know, so he is really the most articulate about saying there is an indifference from the ancient gods to man. Lovecraft takes that an upsy ante to the cosmos.
If you can think of a kind of supernatural horror fiction, it's almost certain that at some point in his career, Lovecraft applied himself to it. And when he got it right, as he often did, nobody could beat him.
Cthulhu, Azathoth, Yog-Sothoth. These are the unspeakable names of the old ones, the very heart of Lovecraft's Cthulhu mythos, a loosely connected canon which has gone on to become one of literature's most influential creations.
I don't know that Lovecraft ever sat down initially and went, "I'm going to grow a grand mythos." I think that, yes, it begins and then everything else sort of fits in.
It's a very complex sort of inbreeding of mythologies. And what the pitch would be that things much older than mankind, things much older than Earth, are gazing upon us with indifference and cruelty.
Those old ones were gone now, hidden in distant wastes and dark places all over the world, until the time when the great priest Cthulhu, from his dark house in the mighty city of R'lyeh under the waters, should rise and bring the earth again beneath his sway.
Instead of it being that there are, demons and coming from hell, there are these weird tentacled creatures coming from other worlds into ours. And that they have been banished, and that they will return someday and regain what was once theirs.
The old ones are the universe, the old ones are the cosmos, they're that force beyond us that we're incapable of controlling, and they're that force, they're the universe that is vaster than we can ever comprehend.
Prior to Lovecraft, if you read horror, if you read ghost stories, you always have a vision of a world which is fundamentally hospitable. God is looking after you. God is looking after the good people. Good people will probably survive horror stories or ghost stories or whatever. Lovecraft redefined things. He took it away from the ghost story, away from the gothic, and into this vision of a malign world. This place surrounded by evil, mad, horrible, monstrous things always trying to get in, who frankly don't really care about us.
But what led an old-world xenophobic gentleman to write these tales of unknown abominations and cosmic gods?
Where bay and tranquil river blend, and leafy hillsides rise, the spires of Providence ascend against the ancient skies, and in the narrow, winding ways, the climb o'er slope and crest, the magic of forgotten days may still be found to rest.
The Phillips House at 454 Angel Street was a vestige of old American values.
Lovecraft's family was very well-to-do, and I believe they considered themselves to be of the Providence aristocracy. The Phillips line goes back very far in Providence history, all the way as early as the late 17th century.
The Lovecraft side originates in England. He could trace that all the way back to about the 15th century. There were Lovecrafts or Lovecrofts in Devon.
He was truly almost a Mayflower specimen, preserved in the formaldehyde of New England, you know. He was an Anglophile. He was a guy that definitely did not get laid much, you know, and a guy that was an alien amongst us, in the sense that he was not a very masculine child.
After Winfield's death from syphilis on July 19, 1898, young Howard was all Susie Lovecraft had left. She mothered her child incessantly, so much so that she was known to make friends stoop when walking hand in hand with her son, for fear his arm would be pulled from its socket. Despite her overattention, Susie Lovecraft's near-puritanical views restrained any physical affections toward her son. Lovecraft would later admit to his only wife that this form of mothering was devastating to him.
His grandfather, Whipple Phillips, was a very impressive industrialist. Lovecraft remembers Whipple telling him oral ghost stories at the age of 4 or 5. Try to take an interest in his education.
In the attic was an immense library, presumably collected by his grandfather. And Lovecraft went up there as a boy with a candle secretly and started reading all these old books and fell in love with the 18th century.
Lovecraft is more than a product of his time. He's a product of a couple of centuries earlier, because he was born out of time.
One of the important things for the 18th century was the code of a gentleman. To live as a gentleman with dignity and honesty and integrity.
He read the literature of the 18th and early 19th centuries and said, I want to be like those people. I want to be like Alexander Pope, who wrote poetry just for the love of it.
I've always had the subconscious feeling that everything since the 18th century is unreal or illusory, a sort of grotesque nightmare or caricature.
Lovecraft learned a lot in his grandfather's house. In fact, all the learning that he had, I think, came from there.
His schooling was intermittent at best. Apparently, he had various nervous maladies that kept him out of school.
This was a time before education was mandatory. You didn't have to send your child to school if you didn't want to. At the age of 8, he became filled with a burning love of chemistry.
Shortly thereafter, he discovered astronomy, which I think was an even more important influence. He says it was through astronomy that he gained a sense of the boundlessness of the universe and the insignificance of humanity within the cosmos.
There's a phrase that generally I only encounter it when reading or talking with people like paleontologists or geologists. The concept of deep time, which is pretty alien to most people. You know, most people tend to think of history in terms of years. Deep time is that time before the comprehension of man. a geological time, is the way of thinking about it, where you're working on a time scale where you talk about things like mountains are pushed up and erode, continents shift, species evolve and become extinct, but it's not really something you can process.
Humanity was limited to Earth, which made humanity itself small and threatened and fragile. So, because he was a threatened and fragile being himself, he populated that emptiness with monsters.
Frequent visits to the attic gave Susie the impression that her son was trying to hide from the world and others, that he was a vulnerable child, uncomfortable with himself.
The relationship of Susie Lovecraft with her son was problematical at best. Clearly she loved him, but I think because of what had happened to her husband, Lovecraft's father, who had died of syphilis, I think she developed some weird love-hate relationship with Lovecraft, called him hideous, said to a neighbor that he had a hideous face, and that's why he wouldn't go outdoors much.
Susie repeated these opinions enough times that her son actually grew to believe them. Insecurity mixed with classical tendencies segregated young Lovecraft from others his age. But this solitary childhood only kindled his imagination.
I used to be tormented constantly with a peculiar type of recurrent nightmare in which a monstrous race of entities, called by me Night Gaunts, used to snatch me up by the stomach and carry me off through infinite leagues of black air over the towers of dead and horrible cities, with vast aggregations of night-black masonry, embodying monstrous perversions of geometrical laws.
Feeding his taste for the macabre was the recent discovery of tales by Edgar Allan Poe.
Lovecraft is the most significant descendant of Poe, and you can see that heritage most clearly in those early stories that evoke effects such as those in the Telltale Heart, say. The Telltale Heart could have been written by Lovecraft.
He may have wanted to be a little like Edgar Allan Poe, but he went in a whole different direction with his imagination.
You know, Poe talked about how a short story should be, everything should be there to create one particular effect, whereas Lovecraft, I think, goes for much more sort of a bigger canvas somehow than Poe did.
In his teenage years, Lovecraft would attempt quite a few stories in the Poe style. Most, however, were destroyed by Lovecraft.
I think too many writers are too hard on themselves, but it has to be said that, you know, Lovecraft epitomizes this trend. And actually, I think if there's one positive thing to be brought out from that, other than that he was a great writer, I think, you know, any writer who feels down about their own work should read Lovecraft's comments about his own work.
He almost never has a good thing to say about his own work. This may be a kind of version of what he perceived as good manners, because there's no doubt that he would have thought it very ill-mannered to praise his own work.
I think that Lovecraft was full of insecurities at that time. He really didn't know what to pursue in terms of a career. Maybe he didn't feel he needed a career, at least in terms of the money, because he felt that money would always be there, but shortly thereafter he discovered the money wasn't going to be there.
In 1904, Whipple Phillips was already suffering from poor investments in a failed dam project. The stress of it all no doubt contributed to his death on March 28th. The house on Angel Street was sold. The library that schooled Lovecraft for 12 years went with it.
He loved that place. He knew the only real security he ever had.
Even though it was only three blocks away, the new home Susie had picked for her son was an unknown country. Though high school would offer some enjoyment, Lovecraft was vexed by the subjects that escaped him.
Lovecraft says he had a full-scale nervous breakdown. We don't really know what that means. I personally believe that it was a result of his discovery that his lack of knowledge or lack of proficiency in mathematics prevented him from pursuing a career as an astronomer.
In the summer of 1908, he simply left school and never returned.
Lovecraft's reclusion would last from 1908 until 1917. Judging from his letters, this breakdown had all the earmarks of a deep depression.
I shunned all human society, deeming myself too much of a failure in life to be seen socially by those who had known me as a youth, and had foolishly expected great things of me.
Lovecraft himself was a pretty crazy person. And he was kind of nuts, wandering around. And I don't mean necessarily, eccentric is a better word.
Even for his time, he must have been not only a recluse, but an oddity.
He would go out occasionally, apparently, and people saw him walking down the street in a raincoat with the flaps up to his collar and looking straight ahead, not trying to make eye contact with anybody.
H.P. Lovecraft was a horror author from the 1920s who created a complex mythology of strange creatures from the boundless depths of outer space who came to rule the world in ancient times. Nowadays, they're trapped beneath the earth, locked by magical bonds which cause them to exist in a strange parallel area between time and space, waiting until they can rise up and rule the world again.
So it's just like Scientology, but less gay.
One activity that endured through this period was his reading. This exposed Lovecraft to the amateur pulp magazines that would one day be the outlet for his own work.
I think amateur journalism saved Lovecraft both as a writer and as a human being. There was Lovecraft in 1913, 1914, basically rotting away. He clearly didn't know what to do with himself. And then all of a sudden, here was this small world of amateur journalism where there are other people like him trying to be writers, but not writing for money. And I think at that moment, that was important to Lovecraft, because amateur journalism was a kind of school for writers.
Lovecraft went on to publish his own amateur magazine, The Conservative. In its pages, he exhibited a strong passion for the beliefs he formed during his isolation, including a pronounced xenophobia.
The most alarming tendency observable in this age is a growing disregard for the established forces of law and order. Whether or not stimulated by the noxious example of the almost subhuman Russian rabble, the less intelligent element throughout the world seems animated by a singular viciousness.
Every artist with every work of art is a product of his or her time. And he reflected a lot of very American feelings.
The failings he had intellectually with beliefs in racism and so on are reprehensible. They were then as they are now, and yet in a sense you can't expect the guy to leap out of his skin and have modern sensibilities.
He had this really archaic, unbudging idea that for society to be stable, then it had to be homogenous.
He just didn't like to see the culture he knew go down the drain, which he felt would happen just by erosion as more and more immigrants came. It's almost a Pat Buchanan kind of a thing.
This absolutely genuine worry of the evils of breeding, of mixed breeding, and breeding in general, I suppose. You know, but the evils of taking purity with an almost Aryan sense of pride.
Regardless, The Conservative attracted fellow amateurs both sympathetic and contrary. They were attracted by Lovecraft's erudite mind.
And as a result, Lovecraft developed very close ties to a number of these amateur journalists. And these became lifelong friends of his, and they exchanged many, many letters even after they had left the amateur journalism movement.
And he kind of found his home in a magazine like that, and other fan magazines that he wrote for. And he found a lot of like-minded souls out there who would read his stuff and really love them. And he developed followers. I mean, it's almost like a cult in him of himself.
He wrote so many letters at such white heat and such intensity and at such length that it's easy to suppose that he sacrificed stories to his correspondence.
I believe he had something like over 120,000 letters written. And these letters aren't short pieces, too. I mean, they're copious, pages and pages of details and notes or suggestions on how to improve their own writing.
As his web of correspondence grew, it also allowed Lovecraft to test early stories on respected readers. In 1919, an amateur journal called The Vagrant took notice. Dagon. was the first of Lovecraft's stories to be printed. A captured sailor escapes German sea raiders, only to come aground on a stretch of sea bottom forced up by a volcanic upheaval.
The region was putrid with the carcasses of decaying fish and of other less describable things, which I saw protruding from the nasty mud of the unending plain.
It's got this this awful sense of atmosphere. The poor guy's out in the middle of nowhere, surely doomed with a black sun scowling on him. What an image.
As the sailor explores the reef, he discovers a cyclopean monolith whose carved surface depicts a race of ancient fishmen.
They were damnably human in general outline, despite webbed hands and feet, shockingly wide and flabby lips, glassy, bulging eyes, and other features less pleasant to recall.
Suddenly, all hell breaks loose with this this huge Charlie Tuna character coming out and embracing this monolith. And then at the end, what happens is the narrator just demented. He's now on the other side of the world, but afraid that old Charlie's following him. And he's, oh my God, the thing in the window. Well, has this creature followed him, or is he just plain nuts? We don't know, but either way, it's a great little story.
But it, you know, you have it there. You've got the creature from the cyclopean creature from the sea. It's virtually Cthulhu in miniature.
Dagon and other stories from this period would set the Lovecraftian model. Scholarly people discovering violations of natural law and being driven towards madness or death. It also exhibited Lovecraft's use of Baroque description and subjective adjectives.
One of the cliche notions of Lovecraft propounded by people who don't very much like his work, usually, is that he only had one style that consisted mostly of piling on the adjectives.
Like, over the eldritch town of Dulwich, the gibbous moon hung illuminating the squamous and batrachian inhabitants. So what he's saying there is just that, the moon was nearly full over the weird town of Dulwich, and everybody who lived there was bloody peculiar frogs.
But Lovecraft is a Baroque writer in the sense that he goes in and carefully modulates this overripe, incredibly convoluted phraseologies and sentences and style, but it's all his own.
If you meet Lovecraft for the first time as an adult, you do kind of have to learn how to read him. It's not a modern style, it's not a stripped-down style, it's not a very efficient style, and there are many, many things about it that are risible. He will pick a few words and overuse them appallingly. Eldritch, gibbous.
But a lot of his stories are all mood. Nothing happens. Especially nothing happens to the narrator. They're just people who start terrified and they end up terrified.
And there are other things you can make fun of him for. The tendency to write in the first person and to keep writing. The ultimate parodic Lovecraftian phrase is somebody going mad while writing and something's coming up. I can hear them now coming up the steps. Their hellish tentacles are squirming at the door. Aya, Shub-Niggurath, the beast with 1,000 young. Fatang, fatang. And you're done. Dot, dot, dot. You disappear in a burst of ellipses and italics.
It's a style that is incredibly anal retentive. And you know this guy went over it and over it and over it until he made the combination that to his taste, which may be gaudy to some, it was in perfect balance.
One thing that influenced this purple style was Lovecraft's current fascination with the writing of Lord Dunsany.
Dunsany wrote these magical little tales of dreamlands and gods, and he has this amazing prose style influenced by the King James Bible and apparently nothing else.
Lovecraft was very taken by Dunsany's creation of a mythical pantheon of gods, and Lovecraft eventually admitted that that's how he came to write the stories of the Cthulhu mythos. He took those Dunsanian gods, which are set in a fantasy world, and put them into the real world, and that's how he came up with his own cosmic mythology.
Though Lovecraft was now a published author, pursuing payment for what was only to be a personal pleasure was far from his idea of a gentleman, an existence that enjoyed being rather than doing. His fellow amateurs urged Lovecraft to go against his anti-commercialism and hire out his skills as a ghostwriter. As an invisible author, Lovecraft would be published many times between 1918 and 1920. With no practical experience in commerce, however, Lovecraft charged rates much lower than the standard of the time, barely clearing a minimum goal of $15 a week. Despite meager returns, this was a prolific time for Lovecraft. By 1921, he had written close to 17 stories.
Unhappy is he to whom the memories of childhood bring only fear and sadness. Wretched is he who looks back upon lone hours in vast and dismal chambers, with brown hangings and maddening rows of antique books.
The glory of the outsider is that it is the story of the thing beyond our ken, briefly coming into the firelight, into that circle, and then fleeing back into the darkness.
A lone narrator emerges from his crumbling castle after a long seclusion. He comes onto the surface of the earth to find people fleeing in terror from a monstrous thing the narrator can plainly see before him.
I love the twist ending, so to speak.
And that you're reading the story and the very last line in the story scares you.
I was proud of this guy as he escaped from these catacombs. And the moment that the real people saw him and screamed and he saw his reflection.
And in horror stretches out his hand and touches a mirror. Boom, that's the end of the story.
Oh my gosh, he is a ghoul, he's a creature from the darkness, now we must go off with him. And I went back and reread it just to see how he'd done that.
At his best, Lovecraft is as much as an existentialist as Albert Camus would be.
I know always that I am an outsider, a stranger in this century and among those who are still men.
This is as strong a statement about how I felt in my teenage years as anything.
He's writing what may very possibly be disguised autobiography. It certainly does seem to be about somebody who had an unhappy childhood and who felt he was physically repulsive.
But did he feel that because of that he was an object of horror, that everybody shunned him?
Certainly, in terms of his physical appearance, he was sort of embarrassed about a number of things. He felt he had these ingrown facial hairs, and that he felt that was a disfiguring factor.
So, in a way, he's kind of using himself as a jumping-off point, but I think he would come off much more as the weirdo that Colin Wilson makes him if he really were like these characters in the stories, and I don't think he was.
When Lovecraft emerged from his own isolation, the consensus of Providence was that the house on Angel Street was one to be avoided, and that Lovecraft and his mother were eccentrics. Though this view could be argued in the case of Lovecraft, Susie was indeed cause for concern. Her home life was one of hypertension, where Susie was known to cause major dramas over the slightest thing. On March 13th, 1919, around the same time her son was emerging as a writer, Susie Lovecraft had been admitted to the same institution that claimed her husband years before. Susie Lovecraft passed away on May 24th, 1921, not from nerves, but from a botched gallbladder operation. Susie's death was hard on Lovecraft, both emotionally and financially. She left her son a meager estate, which was already meager when she inherited it from her father. That inheritance, plus an equally paltry income from ghostwriting, barely met Lovecraft's expenses.
He made little enough money himself and used to survive by eating hideous cans of beans.
But I have to wonder about Lovecraft and whether or not he would have taken any old job just to be able to make money, and I don't think he would. He had a certain set of standards, and again, being, you know, he had a level of pride that, you know, he was a gentleman, he's an author, and he's not going to just take any old job.
Lovecraft moved in with his aunts, Lillian Clark and Annie Gamwell. But aunts were no substitute for a mother. His fiction writing waned. Relief came from one of Lovecraft's fellow journalists.
Herbert West Reanimator actually is a very funny story, and Lovecraft intended it, I think, to be funny. It was commissioned for a humor magazine, for which Lovecraft received all of $5 per installment.
Keep in mind, it was a humor magazine called Home Brew, founded and edited by one of his amateur friends, George Julian Houtain. Houtain said,
"You can't make them too horrible." So clearly, Lovecraft is encouraged to write just the most outlandish, flamboyant horror that he could think of.
Lovecraft chafed under the restrictions of episodic writing. Still, the series debuted in January of 1922 under the banner Gruesome Tales, later to be titled Herbert West, Reanimator.
Of Herbert West, who was my friend in college and in afterlife, I can speak only with extreme terror. Holding with Haeckel that all life is a chemical and physical process, and that the so-called soul is a myth, my friend believed that artificial reanimation of the dead can depend only on the condition of the tissues.
I love the sense of atmosphere on the Herbert West stories, the sense of place that evidently were not in the movie, but that the sense of history, it gives you a sense of place and context that is extremely strong.
Now, a lot of people feel that the influence of Frankenstein is heavy on that story. I disagree, because remember, what Victor Frankenstein was doing was creating an artificial man from different parts of human bodies. What Herbert West is trying to do is reanimate an entire living body after it has theoretically died. A very different conception, I think.
West's adventures in reviving corpses was not among Lovecraft's favorite work, nor his most profitable. Nevertheless, it was a small milestone in his career as a professional writer. During this time, Lovecraft also developed two fascinations incongruent with a xenophobic personality: travel and a woman. Lovecraft had been lured away from Providence for a gathering of amateur journalists in Boston. The prospect of intellectual discourse with his compatriots was too rich to refuse. Rare trips soon became a habit. Even if Lovecraft preferred to stay within the Northeast, where familiar traditions prevailed. On one such visit in 1921, H.P. Lovecraft met Sonia Haft Green of New York. Born on March 16, 1883, Sonia was far more experienced in the ways of the world, having been married once before.
He met this woman who was Jewish.
One of the things that I found reading the letters, Lovecraft's letters, was how anti-Semitic he was. And the idea that he ended up marrying a Jewish woman, I think, is pretty extraordinary.
And she must have looked at him and decided that she wanted him. He wasn't the worst catch in the world. I suppose he had a certain dignity. He was kind of tall and thin and bony.
You know, she was just the opposite of him. You know, she was very outgoing and very social, and she sounded like she was fun. And, you know, she was the one who, as I understand it, introduced him to sex.
It was a shared passion for the literary, however, that attracted them most. During one of many moonlit walks together, Lovecraft and Sonia encountered a weird grunting noise in the night. It was an obvious inspiration for one of his stories, but Lovecraft encouraged Sonia to write it instead. This encouragement earned Lovecraft a kiss, his first since childhood, and that a rare sign of physical affection from his mother. Sonia's story became The Horror at Martin's Beach and was published in 1923. By that time, she had convinced Lovecraft to test the waters of New York City with a prolonged visit.
She knew that Lovecraft had to be taken out of Providence, that if he was going to really have a life, that he had to go out into the world. And she knew how talented he was. And she felt that if he went to New York, that, you know, where the magazines were actually published, and could meet some people, and could, you know, he could become a success.
But in a growing metropolis teeming with immigrants, an acute xenophobic like Lovecraft would soon experience problems. For the moment, though, Lovecraft had every reason to be hopeful. Sonia had entered his life, and in March 1923, Weird Tales magazine was born.
As much as science fiction and fantasy might be marginalized today, it was certainly a lot more marginalized in the 1920s and 30s.
Weird Tales was very influential, as it happened. It was the best of all the pulp magazines. devoted to weird fiction, to horror stories and a certain kind of sci-fi.
Tales of the Fantastic had been increasing in popularity. Publisher J.C. Henneberger saw potential in dedicating an entire journal to the genre.
There was a market there, as low-paying as the market might have been, as marginalized as the magazine might have been. Even though it's being printed on toilet paper, it doesn't matter. There is a market there, and there are readers, and there was a place for it to start.
At their best, it was virtually a roll call of the great pulp fantasy writers, and much better than pulp implies.
Many masters of imaginative fiction got their start in the pages of Weird Tales. H.P. Lovecraft was no different.
Well, Lovecraft regarded Weird Tales as his single market, basically, the one magazine that he was, well, relatively proud to write for, even though it has to be said that he appreciated that the average Weird Tales story, perhaps below average Weird Tales story, was not that great.
It took a great deal of convincing from Sonia and other friends, but Lovecraft finally relented and sent in a selection of stories. Weird Tales bought all five submissions. Thus began a lifelong relationship. On March 3, 1924, Lovecraft embarked on another relationship. After an aggressive campaign from Sonia, Lovecraft finally asked for her hand in marriage. The bride was nearly 41. The groom was 33.
His aunts were outraged by this. You know, they thought that the girl that he married was completely beneath him.
At huge risk to his sense of security, Lovecraft would leave Providence to live with his new wife in New York. For a virgin recluse of Puritan moral standards, marriage promised to be an interesting experience.
Sometimes I feel like she just must have been something just short of a saint.
Because what she married was a guy who refused to work, really, except on his stories. This is the one area in which I think Lovecraft really failed as a human being.
And I think she acknowledged in her own memoir at some point that she felt like she could change him. She couldn't change him.
Between 1922 and 1924, Lovecraft's narrative output was on another upswing. This included the creation of three recurring elements of Lovecraft's gestating mythology: Miskatonic University, the dark town of Arkham, and literature's most dreaded grimoire, written by an alter ego from Lovecraft's childhood, one inspired by his reading of the Arabian Nights, the Mad Abdul Al-Hazaret.
The Necronomicon has become this strange sort of combination of urban legend and bad joke. First of all, it existed in the mind of Lovecraft, and then other people used it. It was one of the easiest things, the Necronomicon of the Mad Arab Al-Hazred. Yes, this is the book of all of the forbidden things.
The Necronomicon was a book that collected all manner of summoning spells. Spells that would cause the return of ancient creatures from unknown worlds and dimensions.
Well, the Necronomicon is yet another of those Lovecraftian concepts that was, you know, never meant to be fully bodied forth. It's a series of references that again imply this much larger tome with more terrible secrets than Lovecraft can even hint at.
So then other people would use it. You got Fritz Leiber, and you got Bloch, and you got Manly Wade Wellman, and August Derleth, all these other writers putting it into their stuff. So now it feels a little truer, like maybe it ought to exist.
Another story from this period can be seen as one of Lovecraft's early best, The Rats in the Walls.
Rats in the Wall was one of two stories that I read when I was a kid. My father bought me a book called Great Tales of Terror and the Supernatural, and it had all sorts of stories in it. Two from Lovecraft, Rats in the Walls and The Dunwich Horror. And he read them aloud to me when I was a kid. It was mind-blowing.
A gentleman of the Delaporte family returns to his ancestral estate in England. There, he and his black cat Nigger Man are disturbed by verminous slithering behind the walls.
Lovecraft was great at depicting the moment of discovery by sound or by a fleeting shadow, and it really put you there and made you almost empathically experience the moment where you heard the noise behind the woodwork.
more than a lot of the stories, it literally embodies that sense of deep time, in the sense of as De La Porte is trying to investigate the source of the phenomena in the house, begins to go through the sub-basement, the sub-sub-basement, down into these vast subterranean caverns beneath the house.
That exploration into the depths of the castle is simultaneously an exploration into the depths of the past and the horrors that come out of history.
I seem to be looking down from an immense height upon a twilit grotto, knee-deep with filth, where a white-bearded demon swineherd drove about with his staff a flock of fungus, flabby beasts, whose appearance filled me with unutterable loathing. Then, as the swineherd paused and nodded over his task, a mighty swarm of rats rained down on the stinking abyss and fell to devouring beasts and man alike.
It's one of the stories where Lovecraft is playing with the classical gothic tropes. You know, you have the family with the hidden things. You have all of these sort of early 18th century gothic elements to the story.
All of this strange stuff about the Exum Priory and this lost world under the cliff there, and these squealing white flabby beasts, and the people, the characters of the stories being descended from different lines, the bad guys that bred these things, and the things having evolved. What a brilliant work!
It's really creepy stuff. It gets under your skin. But I think it's kind of obvious. You tear down the walls of any kind of civilized person, behind there is something that's really abominable lurks.
Rats was snatched up by Weird Tales in 1924. The first year and a half of Lovecraft's marriage was like a tonic.
It was grand. It was a new adventure for him. He also made lots of friends there, too. Frank Long, for example, being one of his best friends.
Work, however, and Lovecraft's drive to find it was limited.
I think, A, he didn't want a job, and B, he knew that any employment he could find in the city of New York or elsewhere would be really bruising for him.
The longer Lovecraft stayed in New York, the worse his xenophobia became. Almost as a retaliation against the immigrant outsiders flourishing around him.
The unraveling of the rug, so to speak, happened, you know, because of financial reasons. Sonia lost her hat shop and eventually had to look for work in Cleveland.
A job offer was greeted with enthusiasm by Sonia and loathing from Lovecraft.
That was too far from Providence. Brooklyn was unbearable, but at least it was just a train ride away.
By the end of 1924, Sonia had no choice but to leave for the Midwest, alone. Sonia would be back and forth to support her husband, but her influence over Lovecraft's mood was waning. His ridicule of the melting pot that was New York City reached manic, even racist levels.
I certainly hope to see promiscuous immigration permanently curtailed soon. Heaven knows, enough harm has already been done by the admission of limitless hordes of the ignorant, superstitious, and biologically inferior scum of Southern Europe and Western Asia.
For the most part, Lovecraft kept these views to himself, knowing full well that his friends and correspondents did not share his views. It wasn't long before his fiction gave voice to these demons.
Red Hook is a maze of hybrid squalor near the ancient waterfront, opposite Governor's Island. From this tangle of material and spiritual putrescence, the blasphemies of 100 dialects assail the sky. Policemen despair of order or reform, and seek rather to erect barriers protecting the outside world from the contagion.
I don't think you can ever correlate what people think or believe with what they write. Or at least I don't think you can do it on the one-to-one basis so beloved of literary scholars, academics, and amateur psychologists.
For modern standards, there is plenty of racism in Mark Twain. There's plenty of racism in Edgar Rice Burroughs. There's plenty of sexism in Edgar Rice Burroughs. You could fault those works for belonging to that time. But I believe that it's actually a fossil record of what a gentleman of New England would think at the time.
It's very, very easy to look at Lovecraft and go, okay, well, you know, Cthulhu means the female genitalia, or all of these outsiders are really Jews, or blacks, or, you know, this is what the Batrachian thing is all about, it's a cunningly disguised racism.
He did, however, make overtly racist statements towards some groups, and that's certainly no surprise back in the 20s and 30s, and it's too bad. I mean, that doesn't make it right, but I just don't think you can take it seriously.
It would be funny if it were not so objectionable, and to a certain extent it still is funny, even though it is completely objectionable. The sheltered character, who took a long, long time to grow. I was going to say never grew up, but that isn't true. And so he's reacting in adolescent fashion to these streams of people who flooded the streets in Brooklyn, in Red Hook, Brooklyn.
And I think when he referred to himself as an unassimilated alien, I think he understood that when he was in New York, on some level he understood, despite all of his protestations, that New York worked. You know, despite his perception of it as this horrid, chaotic cesspool, it was something that worked. He didn't work.
It became clear to friends that Lovecraft's exile in New York was leading to a breakdown. Some even feared a suicide attempt. Help came from Lovecraft's aunts, Lillian and Annie, who found a small home for their nephew back in the safety of Providence. Sonia offered to buy the house for him, but this was not New York. In Providence, propriety would reign. If Lovecraft could not support his wife, he would distance himself instead. In April of 1926, Lovecraft returned to his beloved city.
He was released from Brooklyn, and he went back to his immense, to his almost unimaginably immense relief, to Providence.
That summer of 26 was the start of Lovecraft's richest period. It started with an idea he had outlined during those fearful days in New York, an idea which became the most notable addition to Lovecraft's fictional universe.
Mythology is commonly referred to as the Cthulhu mythos,
named after our great god, Cthulhu. He's this giant green dude with the big head and spores and legs, and he lies sleeping under the ocean in an ancient city called Rrrr.
Dexter and I read all the works of H.P. Lovecraft back in junior high, but we never thought it was true. We just thought it was all made up names and places like Relais and Arkham and Dunwich.
Rhode Island.
Rhode Island has always been real.
I know. See, that's the crazy thing, people. We just found out that all this made-up crap like Raya and Rhode Island actually exist. Tell him how.
I had a dream.
Like Martin Luther King Jr., but 87% more awesome.
The story of Lovecraft, the first one I read was The Call of Cthulhu, like most everyone, I imagine. And it just struck me, because it was a combination of cosmology, anthropology, and horror that was all melded into one.
George Gamal Angel, professor emeritus of Semitic languages at Brown University, is mysteriously murdered on the streets of Providence. Sometime earlier, Angel had come into possession of a troubling clay sculpture.
It represented a monster of vaguely anthropoid outline, but with an octopus-like head whose face was a mass of feelers, a scaly, rubbery-looking body, prodigious claws on hind and forefeet, and long, narrow wings behind.
The description of the monster is probably better seen on paper than it would be visualized. That's the thing about Lovecraft. All his creatures are really interesting when you read them, because your imagination starts to work on it. And you keep it amorphous and disgusting. With the seafood variety that H.P. Lovecraft describes, I mean, he must have had something about fish. Really bothered him, you know? Squid and octopus and stuff like that.
Angel's investigations of the graven image are taken up by his grandnephew.
I mean, here's this guy whose eccentric uncle died, and he's looking through all these papers, as I did when Lynn Carter died. I mean, it's kind of a chore, but you never know what kind of goodies you're going to find, and he sees all these crazy things. What the heck was he into?
When you read it, it's sort of an incredibly clumsy story. It's here's a lump of this, and here's some newspaper reports, and here's a... it's sort of part journalism, and it's almost anecdotal. It doesn't really have a plot.
It's assembled in fragments in a very interesting way, almost a modernist way. And what that technique does is to suggest an aura of mystery in itself.
And before long, he's into it, and before long, he's expecting the secret agents of Cthulhu to come get him. And why is he even writing this thing, since he doesn't want anybody else to know about it?
It's about that recurring thing in Lovecraft, that fear of science or just human knowledge going where it doesn't need necessarily to go, of accidentally uncovering things that either, well, there's not much point in us knowing them, or knowing them could lead to our destruction.
The nephew endeavors to connect reports of vivid dreams across the world, dark practices in the bayous of New Orleans, and the discovery of a corpse city by a band of innocent sailors.
There lay great Cthulhu and his hordes, hidden in green slimy vaults, and sending out at last, after cycles incalculable, the thoughts that spread fear to the dreams of the sensitive.
Cthulhu is almost like the Paul Revere of all these deities, you know, or the King Arthur, waiting to come back, you know, and take over him.
He's just a general evil that exists in another place, but it's like Christianity in a sense. It's, in a sense, our creator. He's our destroyer. He's kind of another version of the devil, I suppose, except slimier.
As elaborate as this story was, the spelling and pronunciation of the ancient names was even more so.
Cthulhu.
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 Of course, the discrepancy on the enunciation of the name, you may have, this is my fourth language.
Poppy Z. Bright makes fun of the way I pronounce Cthulhu, but I don't know another way. You know, I look at the way Lovecraft tried to pronounce it, and I can't pronounce it.
Many of his colleagues apparently didn't know how to pronounce it or pronounced it wrongly. And so finally, in a letter of 1934, he tells a colleague, well, it's really meant to be two syllables. You're supposed to put your tongue at the roof of your mouth and cough it out like Clulu. But he says, you know, the name is an entirely alien name not designed to be pronounced by human vocal cords.
The word is only a symbol for something that is entirely beyond the ability for humans to make the sound. So there is no incorrect way to pronounce it because there's no correct way to pronounce it.
Despite Lovecraft's efforts to weave a rich narrative, the call of Cthulhu was initially rejected by Weird Tales. This was common practice of the anthology's editor, Farnsworth Wright, especially when presented with a story as original as Lovecraft's creation.
One of Lovecraft's tricks, of course, was to take the rejected story, sit on it for a little while, send it back to Wright saying, well, I've made the changes you asked for, having not done a single thing with it. And more often than not, apparently, Wright would fall for this trick.
The Call of Cthulhu was eventually printed in February 1928's issue of Weird Tales. Lovecraft's fee for such a seminal work of fiction? $165. As Lovecraft's writing began to blossom, so did the man.
I vastly regret the absence of traditional accomplishments, fencing, horsemanship, military service, caused by my early ill health and lack of appreciation of the quality of well-roundedness.
Lovecraft began to entertain his friends once more, including them on long walks through Providence and other New England excursions. Lovecraft was even beginning to evolve a form of tolerance toward the outsiders around him, especially the many cultures now living in Providence. In February of 1927, it was time for his writing to expand as well.
Charles Dexter Ward is the novel in which he applies all his sense of structure to that long work, and the effect is tremendous.
The beginning of Ward's madness is a matter of dispute among alienists. Dr. Lyman, the eminent Boston authority, places it in 1919 or 1920. This is certainly borne by Ward's altered habits, especially by his continuing search for a certain grave dug in 1771, the grave of an ancestor named Joseph Curwen.
Joseph Curwen was an obscure individual who fled from Salem to Providence around 1761.
Now, the first odd thing about Joseph Curwen was that he did not seem to grow much older than he had been on his arrival. At length, when over 50 years hence the stranger's advent, and without producing more than 5 years apparent change in his face and physique, the people began to whisper more darkly.
Alchemy and the black arts proved to be Kerwin's secret.
I think one of the flaws of that story, and it may be only a flaw to me, is that it uses a kind of pseudoscience that is actually a little bit beneath Lovecraft's acumen. It explains mysterious and horrifying events by reference to certain essential salts.
And by the like method from the essential salts of humane dust, a philosopher may, without criminal necromancy, call up the shape of any dead ancestor.
And that's a little third rate. It's like bad science fiction.
A band of raiders confront the doomed man and his unhallowed wizardry. That night was never remarked on again, until Charles Ward learned of his descent from Kerwin in 1918, and continued his ancestors' experiments, connecting the past with the present, summoning the unspeakable to life.
It's almost like a detective story. You know, Dr. Willett is really discovering what happened to Charles Dexter Ward, you know, discovering about Kerwin and the unfortunate accidents from the efforts to basically bring demons down from the stars. And when they didn't have all the pieces, when they didn't have all the remains, you know, terrible awfulness would be brung up and they'd had to be put somewhere. Of course, I wasn't quite sure why they just didn't just sport. Who knows?
It's one of those cases where his detractors say, well, he's writing about unspeakable horrors and simply telling us that they're unspeakable. In fact, if that's all you get out of the moment where Dr. Willett looks down the well and sees something, that Lovecraft actually certainly finds a metaphor for it, that there's tremendously more there than just the unspeakable. There's the cosmic in bodily form.
Though completed, the lengthy tale of Charles Dexter Ward was never typed or submitted.
He just left it in a drawer. He didn't think it was worth bothering with. It was a first draft, amazingly. I believe Dream Quest of Unknown Kadath was also. How he didn't see the merit in this stuff is just amazing.
I don't think he was built to write longer narratives. He went as far as he could that way, and he did press the envelope. Some of those last stories are really rather long, but they're also inert in a certain way that a novel cannot afford to be.
There was another tale written during this time on which Lovecraft held an entirely different opinion.
The Color Out of Space is just a great science fiction movie, a story. It should be a movie, although I don't know how you do the color, because it's like unlike anything we've seen, and I don't know what that is.
There is a type of story where you go to the minimal setting, a household in a farm or in a far field, and you unleash upon them a cosmic melody, you know, a cosmic curse.
It all began in 1882 with a meteorite.
And by night, all Arkham had heard of the great rock that fell out of the sky and bedded itself in the ground beside the well at the Nahum Gardner place. They had uncovered what seemed to be the side of a large colored globule embedded in the substance. The color, which resembled some of the bands in the meteor's strange spectrum, was almost impossible to describe, and it was only by analogy that they called it color at all.
And the color out of space, it is, as the story has it, just a color out of space. It's literally indescribable in prose terms.
It's something that's almost impossible to even detect. It's something that's so incredibly insidious that there's no escaping from it, except by geographically removing yourself as far as you can from the place.
By the next harvest, flora and fauna are found deformed, and the Gardner family is infected with an unexplained madness.
It happened in June, about the anniversary of the meteor's fall, and the poor woman screamed about things in the air which she could not describe. In her raving, there was not a single specific noun. She was being drained of something. Something was fastening itself on her that ought not be.
You know, it wasn't just a meteorite, it was something inside the meteorite that begins to spread and poison the landscape and mutate the landscape and the people.
It's on those stories of Lovecraft that, moves into physical gruesomeness, the effects on the unlucky family in the farmhouse, but then it passes beyond that into absolute awesomeness, a kind of real transcendental quality of terror that the best of Lovecraft achieved.
Though the call of Cthulhu looked to the stars, the color out of space was clearly set in the realm of science fiction. For this very reason, Lovecraft submitted his tale to the new journal Amazing Stories. Though they would eagerly publish the story in September of 1927, their lack of payment convinced Lovecraft that he should never stray far from the known quantity of weird tales. They would be the only magazine he formally submitted to for the rest of his life. During a 1928 excursion to Massachusetts, Lovecraft happened on a ring of stones.
Oldest of all are the great rings of rough-hewn stone columns on the hilltops, more generally attributed to the Indians than to the settlers.
Along with talk of witch blood, the eerie cries of the whippoorwills, and the ever-present old ones, Lovecraft shaped the Dunwich horror. It was in the township of Dunwich that Wilbur Whately was born on the 2nd of February, 1913.
Lavinia Whately had no known husband, but according to the custom of the region, made no attempt to disavow the child.
There is an inbreeding between, you know, gods and man, and that you produce, you know, what did you produce? You got this, you know, half god, half man thing.
Wilbur Whately's grandfather is old Wizard Whately. He's an eccentric New England hick. What's his motivation? Is he trying to end the world because he's some kind of Sadian nihilist? No, he just needs a few extra bucks. Yog-Sothoth agrees to give him pirate doubloons if he pimps out his daughter to him.
At the age of 10, Wilbur Whately attained an unnatural size, that of a fully grown man.
His facial aspect, too, was remarkable for its maturity. Exceedingly ugly despite his appearance of brilliancy, there being something almost goatish or animalistic about his thick lips, large, pawed, yellowish skin, coarse, crinkly hair, and oddly elongated ears.
What troubled the residents of Dunwich even more were the number of cattle purchased by old Whately without ever increasing the size of his stock, and the dreaded something being kept in the upper part of the Whately farmhouse.
There are twins that were born to Lavinia, and the, you know, one is a normal, mostly normal looking, you know, 8 foot tall, goatish looking man, and, you know, and a half seen, you know, or invisible half brother, which is much more like his father.
Soon, a mysterious thunder was heard in the woods. Livestock and eventually entire families disappeared. And Wilbur Whately was discovered breaking into Miskatonic Library in search of a complete Necronomicon, one that contained the rites for the Old One's return.
Yog-Sothoth knows the gate. Yog-Sothoth is the gate. Yog-Sothoth is the key and guardian of the gate. Past, present, future, all are one in Yog-Sothoth.
The Dunwich Horror earned Lovecraft his biggest payday from Weird Tales, $240. But again, Lovecraft failed to capitalize on his success and would not write for more than a year. This time, Lovecraft's reticence was due to a desire for artistic growth.
There are my Poe pieces and my Dunsany pieces, but alas, where are my Lovecraft pieces?
Lovecraft's writing, on the surface, appears to be imitations of other writers.
If you see the early stories, there is a much more constrained sense of scope. And towards the end of his life, he was gaining as a writer, I think, and gaining as an artist and as a human being, and his view of the world became more ample.
And I think when Lovecraft shed the influence of Dunsany and started writing like Lovecraft, that's when things take off.
He was writing much better fiction. He was writing much more contemporary fiction. In many senses, I mean, in the sense that the language was more contemporary and the settings were more contemporary.
You can even see how some of his descriptions start becoming more specific. You know, they go from being unnameable, obscene things to being described as a cucumber body with so-and-so tentacles with proboscis or proboscis in its end. And, you know, he really started relishing that. And he started giving a sense of dignity and history to these creatures that I think is unique.
With Providence as a lifeline, Lovecraft was emboldened to venture further and further in art and in life. His correspondents engaged in healthy discussions on race, men, and civilization. The more Lovecraft exposed himself to other opinions and places, the more his views and phobias began to soften. This self-improvement did not extend to his marriage, however. Since his return to Providence, Sonia had seen very little of her husband. While she remained in New York for the sake of a career, Lovecraft favored his cherished city. On March 25, 1929, after constant pleas from Sonia, the Lovecrafts filed for a divorce. Sonia went on to Europe, a place Lovecraft had always longed to visit, but never did. Later, she moved to California, where she remarried and led a full life until 1972. In 1930, Lovecraft had begun work on a new tale. By the time it was published in August of 1931, the changes in Lovecraft could be glimpsed on the page.
Well, we need to celebrate the Whisperer in Darkness because, of course, the astronomers have now taken the planetary status away from Pluto, which is to say, you know, Yuggoth, Black Yuggoth on the rim. And in fact, the Whisperer in Darkness was Lovecraft's reaction to the discovery of a new planet.
After a rash of unprecedented floods in Vermont, misshapen cadavers wash up along the riverbanks.
They were pinkish things, about 5 feet long, with crustaceous bodies bearing vast pairs of dorsal fins or membranous wings, and several sets of articulated limbs.
Albert N. Wilmarth of Miskatonic University begins to investigate the origins of these alien things.
The blasphemies that appeared on the Earth came from the dark planet Yuggoth. But this was itself merely the populous outpost of a frightful interstellar race whose ultimate source must lie far outside even the Einsteinian space-time continuum.
It's actually one of Lovecraft's most restrained stories. There are very few of those runs of adjectives. Most of it is done as a series of letters, something I imagine he probably learned just to some extent from the novel Dracula, which he greatly admired.
Through the first-hand contact of his colleague, Henry Akeley, Wilmarth learns of the dark intentions behind the buzzing creatures. What Akeley deems a deadly danger, however, turns out to be something else entirely.
In the last stage of Lovecraft's career, when he began to write the best stories, in spite of their being what I called inert earlier, you can see him taking a different angle of vision on the monsters at the heart of what is known as the mythos. The Whisperer in Darkness is probably the first story in which one begins to see this shift in attitude. They're still frightening, and when their voices are recorded on tape, they are intensely scary beings. But they may not be completely inimical to the human race.
In fact, the fungi from Yuggoth wish to expand man's senses to enable his exploration of the cosmos and its secrets. This process, however, involves removing the brain and placing it in a cylinder for the journey, all in the spirit of discovery, but hardly harmless.
It's all a scam. It's like people today that say, oh, there's no problem with Islamofascism. Yeah, we're the problem. These people are merely misunderstood. Nah, you're wrong, and you better hope you don't pay with your life for this stupidity. And Wilmarth's getting sucked into this thing, and it isn't even Akeley anymore. His brain's in a can somewhere, and he's being led off the path by the buzzing lobsters and all that. So you're being set up if you think that's the case.
Still, the Whisperer in Darkness could be seen as a sign of tolerance to come. During the last years of his life, Lovecraft's travels continued to expand his first-hand knowledge of the changing world around him. He was making up for lost time.
But this long-deferred semi-introduction to the world did not take as thoroughly as it might have done had I been chronologically younger.
Lovecraft's funds could not keep up with his thirst for growth. Ghostwriting continued, but its anonymity was becoming unattractive all the more. So in early 1931, Lovecraft began work on another original story, a tale of ancient Antarctic horror.
It is altogether against my will that I tell my reasons for opposing this contemplated invasion of the Antarctic, with its vast fossil hunt and its wholesale boring and melting of the ancient ice cap. To deter the exploring world in general from any rash and overambitious program in the region of those mountains of madness.
Some of the descriptive passages in At the Mountains of Madness seem to me to rank with the great geographical fantasies of literature. Actually, I think it's a painterly quality in that novel that you perhaps don't find so much in his other work.
It is one of those places where all of the different influences come together. The idea of you're trekking across the ice. It's quite horrible. It's Antarctica, and it is science fiction. It's about an incursion by aliens.
In the foothills of these towering cliffs, an expedition discovers the fossil remains of a pre-Cambrian race.
Found monstrous, barrel-shaped fossil of wholly unknown nature. In furrows between ridges are curious growths, combs or wings that fold up and spread out like fans. Arrangement reminds one of certain monsters of primal myth, especially fabled elder things in Necronomicon, supposed to have created all Earth life as jest or mistake.
One of the most horrific ideas was that the things that the scientists were studying started almost dissecting them. You know, that is a revelation of intelligence and curiosity. The sense of curiosity these things had, leaving little trails around the equipment and so forth, that was what was so scary to me. Something terribly odd and horrifying chased these men out, you know, and something that was supposed to be a fossil record is after them.
After the mysterious and utter annihilation of an advance team, the survivors of the unfortunate expedition discover a Cyclopean city hidden among the peaks. There, they learn the tragic history of the star-headed Elder Things, their shaping of life on Earth, surviving war with other races of cosmic infinity, and falling prey to their slave race of Shoggoths, protoplasmic masses capable of molding their tissues into all sorts of forms.
You know, in the 60s, there was the idea that aliens had come here and had kind of created the human race. But that idea really was old compared to what Lovecraft had dreamed up, which was the idea of these battling alien forces, you know, on Earth, and that man ended up somehow inheriting this thing almost by default because these two major presences had sort of wiped each other out.
The old ones in Mountains of Madness are scientists. They were artists. They were architects. They are tentacled cucumbers with wings, but they are sentient, intelligent beings. And that sense of intelligence makes the evil at work in Lovecraft's stories much more intense.
At the Mountains of Madness also displayed two new reactions to the fictional unknowns, fellowship and empathy.
It's a real imaginative achievement for him to have seen these threatening beings in a warmer light, eventually. He kind of fell in love with them. He'd been in love with them all along, actually.
The old ones, they may have been crinoid, pickle-shaped barrels with wings and starfishes for heads and a bad sense of humor, but they were men. But why is that? Because now they got the rebellious slaves, the Shoggoths, to worry about. So has Lovecraft seen a different group as the same as him because all people are equal, or he sympathizes with them as slave owners who are now on the run from an even weirder race? So I don't know what that means, really. Not so bad. There's the elitists like I am against the uppity bad guys.
I think there is a huge Lovecraftian influence and a huge At the Mountains of Madness influence on the first Ridley Scott Alien. The idea of a ship that essentially lands on a planet and they find a derelict city-sized ship, dead denizens in it, and something that is very much alive and waiting and then takes over the humans, that's essentially you could say, very much at the mantle of madness. It has influenced the story that The Thing was based on, which was a direct ripoff of At the Mantle of Madness. So I think its repercussions are very cinematic.
This was the crowning jewel of the Cthulhu mythos.
It clearly came as a crushing blow when Farnsworth Wright, editor of Weird Tales, rejected it. By then, sadly, Lovecraft had really decided that, you know, he no longer had any ability to express, convey the kind of thing he wanted to convey. He was to write very little prose fiction for the last few years of his life.
Though more stories were attempted over the next few years, most, like The Shadow Over Innsmouth, were problematic for Lovecraft.
Lovecraft himself seemed almost embarrassed by The Shadow Over Innsmouth, and I think probably he undoubtedly understood that it was, in a sense, a kind of reversion, a hearkening back to the same sort of xenophobic prejudices that he had embraced in his youth.
And why is everybody so down on Innsmouth? Some of the stories would make you laugh about old Captain Marsh driving bargains with the devil and bringing imps out of hell to live in Innsmouth. Some of them have queer, narrow heads with flat noses and bulgy, starry eyes that never seem to shut, and their skin ain't quite right.
These things are creatures that are born looking normal, and the older they get, the stranger they become, until eventually their transformation will be complete and they'll slither off into the sea where they will live forever.
It's definitely a sort of biological horror story where you have the breakdown of not just human society, but of the human body. But I think the overriding concern is actually about culture. You have the culture of the Deep Ones coming up and over the decades eating away the culture of Innsmouth so that finally Innsmouth will vanish.
There is, to be sure, a kind of racist or xenophobic undercurrent to that story, but I think it's very subtle and very, very indirectly expressed. I'm now beginning to think it must be one of Lovecraft's one or two best stories.
And he does something that you don't see a whole lot of Lovecraft doing in writing action scenes. You know, I still think that the escape from the Gilman Hotel is a marvelous action scene. And running across and running into the parade of horrific frogfish things, it's wonderful and not the sort of thing that he did a lot.
Lovecraft never formally submitted The Shadow Over Innsmouth for publication.
Partially, Lovecraft marginalized himself because he was never very complimentary of his own work. But I think readers and critics neglected to see the imagination at work behind what he wrote.
It would be a few more years before modern tastes turned in his favor. At the end of 1935, New York agent Julius Schwartz was able to sell the previously rejected At the Mountains of Madness. Thanks to the efforts of Donald Wandry, The Shadow Out of Time sold soon after, giving Lovecraft his highest combined payday, a total of $595. By the end of 1936, just as success seemed a possibility, Lovecraft's health began to diminish.
In many ways, I think if Lovecraft had preserved his health, he would have become a well-known writer in the 40s and 50s if he had lived that long. I think Lovecraft really died at the pinnacle of his talent.
Lovecraft had been suffering from a small collection of ailments, including digestive trouble. By the time he submitted to a doctor's diagnosis, the cancer had spread through his small intestine. H.P. Lovecraft died on the morning of March 15th, 1937. He was 46 and a half years old.
Although he knew himself celebrated in a small circle, he never broke through to the public in any sense at all. And therefore, when he died, he would have been justified in thinking himself as a failure or as a very, very obscure writer.
If it weren't for Lovecraft's disciples, he would have been forgotten. That it was people like Derleth and Robert Bloch and so forth that kept Lovecraft alive, and they went out and actually got his books published.
In 1939, August Derleth and Donald Wandry, two of Lovecraft's most earnest supporters, achieved what no one had been able to do in Lovecraft's lifetime. They founded Arkham House, and released a collection of stories entitled The Outsider and Others by H.P. Lovecraft.
Well, Arkham House came into being virtually out of Lovecraft's death. I mean, almost immediately on the news of Lovecraft's death reaching August Erleth.
It existed initially to publish Lovecraft and then continued with an astonishing record as a small press.
Following on from which, they decided to do more Lovecraft and then indeed to do more of the other great writers from Weird Tales, Clark Ashton Smith, for instance, and indeed Wanderer himself.
You know, Arkham House books became, for the most part, incredibly valuable incredibly quickly. They were sought after by book collectors, not because they were rare, but because they were good.
For certainly a decade or more, there was no publisher other than Arkham House specializing in mainly supernatural horror, a very small smattering of science fiction.
It was a cheap, disposable literature. And Arkham House was one of the very first places to actually say some of this stuff needs to come out respectably.
Since the success of Arkham House, many writers have continued to expand the Cthulhu mythos. In fact, this was a practice Lovecraft encouraged when he was alive.
That's part of the Lovecraft game is, you know, it's like you get it and you want to add to it and pass it on. And it's been part of the Lovecraft game from the very beginning. The Fritz Leibers, the Bob Blochs, all of these people, and August Erleth, they took a little of this, took the story, added to it, passed it on. And so then we started doing it.
The problem when I was a teenager was, you know, I read Lovecraft and I thought, this is how you do it. But unfortunately, what I meant by this to myself was, you know, this is how you imitate it. And worse still, although I've never been more than 20 miles away from Liverpool in England, I set these stories in Massachusetts, you know, in Arkham and places like that, Kingsport. And it was painfully obvious that I'd never been very far from Liverpool, particularly when the rustics opened their mouths.
If you read a story like The Mist, King's novella, that's pure Lovecraft. It's about these tentacle things breaking through from some other dimension and terrorizing a grocery store in guess where, Maine. That's pure Lovecraft, I'm sure.
I did a story called Shoggoth's Old Peculiar, in which I have two Lovecraftian beasties complaining about Lovecraft as a writer. But the truth is that we only parody things that have life. There is no point in parodying something dead. There is no point in parodying something in which one has no interest. There's no point in parodying or making fun of something that doesn't matter. And almost 100 years after his death, Lovecraft still matters.
And it is a passion that continues to this day, even in the face of criticism.
Well, there's always going to be a kind of snobbery about supernatural horror fiction, I think. You know, I mean, the writer needs to be dead for maybe 100 years before he's fully taken seriously.
Every creator that dwells in the genre must assume his work will not be appreciated as if he was doing straight stuff.
It's been ghettoized. It's really not the proper occupation of a serious writer. But look what happened when Stephen King won that award a few years ago. People immediately started putting him down because he wasn't writing serious stuff.
It's very easy for us now to forget in a world in which, you know, as a fantasy, horror, science fiction, whatever the hell I am author, my books are going to come out in hardback just like anybody else's, and they're going to be on those shelves just like anybody else's. That didn't used to be the case.
But I think probably at the moment that we saw Lovecraft in the Penguin Modern Classics, I think there's no question whatsoever that he's fully established, and about time too.
He has been translated into something like 25 languages around the world, from Czech to Polish to Japanese, Korean. There's a Bengali edition.
A lot of people kind of get introduced to Lovecraft not even knowing that it's Lovecraft. You know, you've got things like, you know, Hellboy, which is, you know, borrowing very heavily from, you know, the Lovecraft mythos, and even things like Pirates of the Caribbean, where you've got Davy Jones is looking, it's like, you know, he crawled out of Lovecraft, you know, it looks like Cthulhu.
you look around these days and you get the plush Cthulhu phenomenon. You get Cthulhu slippers. You get funny Cthulhu hats.
One of the things that I think is so amazing is I've met a group of people who were into playing these like Call of Cthulhu games and so forth. And they knew all of the Lovecraft creatures, but they had never, ever read Lovecraft. They didn't know what the stories were.
His images are so outré and ghastly and macabre and colorful that they influence all kinds of rock and roll bands.
I think he also literally appeals to the outsider and the person who is not well accepted in society, who's a little bit of a loner.
I think one of the reasons that Lovecraft is so popular today is that his view, which is a very dark one, you know, that man is lucky to be ignorant, I think is what he used to say, because if he knew the truth, he would either go crazy or he would kill himself, is one that everyone can relate to these days.
Every election, you see the bumper stickers saying, "Vote for Cthulhu, why settle for the lesser evil?"
Such is Lovecraft's fame that some occultists insist the Cthulhu mythos is no myth.
See, in Lovecraft's story about Cthulhu, we learn that he reaches out to sensitive artistic people and sends them strange dreams to let the puny mortals know he exists. In my dream, I saw Cthulhu, what he actually looks like. He's got a great big bulbous head and big flapping eyes. He's got these little tiny wings on his back that just go, and little tiny legs. And he's got these big face tentacles that flap. Blink, 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 blink. And that's basically what the great god Cthulhu looks like.
In fact, I have drawn a picture. See? He's huge. I mean, in order to give you a sense of his scale, I have created this unit of measurement called my penis. As you can see, he is 4,372 my penises wide by 13,845 my penises tall, giving Cthulhu a total area of 13,577 my penises square.
That doesn't tell us anything. I mean, how big is your penis?
Dude, be crass. Broadcast this on the internet. There's no place to talk about the size of my penis.
Cthulhu doesn't have eyebrows.
Yes, he does.
And he's flabbier than that. He doesn't have big pecs and abs.
He could have big pecs if he wanted them.
He's been under the ocean for eons. He's more bloated.
It's an artist's misrepresentation.
Well, you're not the artist. I am. That's why I got the dream. I got the dream so I know what he looks like because I got the dream, okay?
Fine. You know everything because you had the dream, even though I know everything there is to know about Cthulhu. You're the boss because you had the dream. So if you would like to join our super fun kick-ass cult, just send an email to the address at the bottom of the screen. And then Chuck the Dreamhaver can boss you around too. I'm going to turn this off.
I know every religion begins as the delusion of one or two people, and once enough people sign on, it becomes a world view, and if you can inhabit it and live everyday life, then it no longer seems insane. But when you're one of the very few who believe it, there's a kind of an intensity that results in an unbalanced character, and that's what I'm afraid of with cultists that actually believe there are old ones.
I think that every time somebody comes out with a world as fully fleshed as Lovecraft creates, you are bound to find people that will start speaking Klingon or dressing like a hobbit to go to the supermarket or believe that they can actually channel in a couple of old ones into their living room. You know, and I believe that some people have actually even died trying to invoke some of the ancient gods.
I knew people that handled Star Wars this way. They were so absorbed in it. One of them wished it were true, you could tell, and another believed that it was all true in a parallel world. And, you know, you're beginning to go off the deep end.
So, you know, I would definitely not advise to put too much money or effort into invoking that Shoggoth into the kitchen, but it's up to you.
The oldest and strongest emotion of mankind is fear. And the oldest and strongest kind of fear is fear of the unknown.
We live in a world in which, even if you don't know who Cthulhu is, even if you've never read any Lovecraft, you can kind of get the jokes.
And while certainly there have been far too many people, not least me, you know, imitating him too closely, you know, he also has had a profound influence on people as diverse as Fritz Leiber, as Poppy Z. Bright, Caitlin Kiernan, Ted Klein, you name it.
For me, what is the brilliance of Lovecraft, what's so important about Lovecraft, is his is simply his imagination.
It's incredible. To think that this guy who was this recluse living in this, you know, little house in Providence, Rhode Island, ends up spawning, you know, essentially modern day horror.
It's the duality of Lovecraft. It's the fact that people can take the ideas almost as the basis of a religion. People can take the ideas from a serious academic point of view or from a writing point of view, and then you can then if you just like drawing great big monsters, Lovecraft is waiting for you too.
Dexter, damn it, man. Don't be like that.
You hurt my feelings.
You're talking angry.
No, I know.
You say
it's
things
I'm angry.
You regret,
it's
and
a
then
reflection
my feelings
of reality.
Get hurt.
It's about
and you're
reality.
Wasting battery
How
time.
How the hell do you turn this off?
Well, just let it run out to the battery's dead.
No, I'm not going to do that. That's
okay, pull the battery out.
Man, we're a green cult.
Run downstairs and flip the circuit.
We're a total green cult.